This is APT, Alabama Public Television, Channel 10 in Birmingham.
Probably one of the highlights of my career was that Red came to Owensboro one time to race, and I got to see a living legend. Little did I know he was going to live on and on and on. I don't know, how old is he now, about 82 or so?
First time that I remember seeing Red Farmer, I guess I was in my early 20s, and I went over to Birmingham. That's back when if you made a mistake, you could go over the corner and end up in the horse lots in the middle of number one and two corner. And I think Red won the race there. And I figure if he stays in the sport a couple more years, he'll have enough experience maybe to get into the big time racing or something.
My first advice from Red was about a dog when I was about 5 years old. We named him Underdog.
But first time I ever saw Red was when my granddaddy took me out to Opa-locka when I was about 9 years old. And Red was one of the really hot rod youngsters out there that was zooming around that track. And of course I got all fired up. Racing was about the only thing I could think of for about the next 6 or 8 years. And I finally started running the jalopy division, and of course got to know who he was and everything. And then went off for about a year after I got out of high school, went to work for Keycaper and stayed out of town, stayed gone for about a year. And when I got back from that venture is when I accepted a job of helping on Red's crew. And, you know, of course he had Homer Warren heading things up and Wayne Cackley and two other youngsters worked along with me, Roger and Bill Purdom. And of course we were the crew for the spectacular Red Farmer.
Side by side, door handle to door handle, coming through the trioval once again. Look at Red Farmer sneak up on Gibson and Waywack through here. Red Farmer, of course, in that trailing yellow car, the original member of the Alabama gang. Now he's right up on the back bumper of Mark Gibson as they move into turn number one. Gibson takes the position away from Waywack, and here comes Red Farmer racing side by side with Waywack off of corner number two and down the backstretch. So some real great competition.
Red Farmer has been racing stock cars for 38 years. To date, he has made 700 trips to Victory Lane.
I like things that go fast, 'cause I know the good things don't ever last. I like believing in what I want to. I don't like no one to tell me what to do.
Stock car racing began on the water's edge of Daytona Beach, Florida, back in 1936. The sport quickly gained popularity, and the beaches filled with racing fans who wanted to learn as much as possible about this new high-speed sport. In 1949, a young man named Charles Farmer knew very little about stock car racing. He was living in Hialeah, Florida, and attending high school at the time. The nearest races were run at Opa-locka Speedway, but it was on this track that Charles Red Farmer drove his first race car on a dare.
We went out to the races in Opa-locka, Florida, and it wasn't really a racetrack. It was a old abandoned airstrip that they used to run down one asphalt, cut through the grass, and come back the other one, cut through the grass, and get on two different straightaways and run it. And Earl had asked me, he said, you think that looks like a lot of fun, don't it? I said, yeah, it sure does. He said, how would you like to try that? I said, well, you know me, I'd try anything once. He said, well, my daddy got a car and said his driver quit last week out there. If you want to, said, I'll ask daddy if you can drive his car next week. I said, why not? So anyway, make a long story short, that's what happened. I got out there in his car, old 34 sedan, first time on a racetrack, I went flying down that straightaway, slung it in that dirt track and flipped it about four times. First time I ever got on a racetrack, I turned the car about four times. And it didn't hurt me, but it was exciting to me. And that's actually how I got started. And the bug kind of bit me after that, because And then I started running pretty regular after that in Opa-locka, Florida back in 1949, and been doing it ever since.
I really didn't know very much about racing, to tell you the truth. I'd never been into that at all. And when he said he had already tried it and wanted my permission to go on with it, I just really didn't know what to do, because knowing him, I figured he was going to do it anyway. So I thought, well, I might just well give my permission and make it legal, you know, and I thought that might be better. So I did.
Although Farmer had been bitten by the racing bug, he knew his future depended on a more secure profession. He graduated high school and trained to be an electrician.
So I went ahead and went to trade school for 5 years and got my German's license in the IBEW and got my German's card. And then I started racing. But till I had that in my pocket, I didn't go racing for a living. So I had a trade that I could fall back on if I could make it. And then I made the decision that I wanted to try to race for a living. And I gambled and went out on my own to try to be a professional racer and do it for a living.
Racing continued to be a passionate hobby for Red. By this time, he had married. He and his wife, Joan, had started their family.
I was all for him racing for a living and it becoming his career, because truthfully, I think down deep in my heart, I didn't think he would stick with it. So, you know, I agreed wholehearted to it.
In the late 1950s, the Cuban crisis halted most of the construction work in the Miami area.
Well, those were tough days back in the early years when they first came up here. Actually, I was kind of forced in Alabama by necessity. At the time, I had five dependents and a grandmother that lived with me at the time, and I was an electrician by trade. And the trouble with the Cuban crisis come up right across from Miami, not 60 miles away. The construction work kind of slowed down. It's like the oil crisis we're having nowadays. Everybody in the oil fields are out of business, kind of the price of oil. Well, it was the same way in Miami. The construction business, really, the bottom fell out of it.
Farmer said the only thing he owned during this slow period was a race car. Now, by this time, Bobby Allison had located a sponsor and had made a trip to Alabama, where he saw some great racetracks.
I couldn't wait to get back home and tell Red about this tremendous paradise we'd found.
I come to Birmingham, Alabama, and run an old Dixie Speedway out in Midfield. Pulled all the way up here with a station wagon with a two-wheel trailer behind it. It was about a 25-hour trip from then, because there was no interstates, and we come up Old Tulane all the way from Miami, Florida. And I come up to, very fortunate enough to come up Dixie Speedway, and I won the race, first time I've ever been on a racetrack. And it paid about $400. Well, $400 don't seem like much now, but when you was living on $60 a week, I done made 2 or 3 months pay there in one day.
Everybody remembers when Red first got here, because over about a two-week period, he won all but one race, and it was a holiday period, so there were a lot of races, 8 or 9 races over about a two-week period, and Red won all but one of them, and it was pretty spectacular.
Of course, Bobby, at the time, he'd just started racing, and in 55 and 56, Bobby started helping me on the race cars when he was still what I call straight line at drag racing. And then he got into the round track racing, and he'd come up to Montgomery. I don't really particularly know the reason why he happened to end up in Montgomery, but he came up in Montgomery race car, and I think he won Montgomery and made that $300 or $400 at that time. And at that time, that was big money for us. So it enticed us all, really, to come up and try it.
Breaking into the racing profession was not easy. Red was his own mechanic. Oftentimes, the person who was there to assist him was his wife, Joan, who on more than one occasion stood at his side holding their bedroom lamp for her husband's late night work. Now, Red Farmer had made up his mind. Stock car racing was what he wanted to do, and that's the way he wanted to earn his living. Now, by the late 50s, it appeared that the best place to earn a good living was in Alabama. So Red Farmer, Bobby Allison, and Bobby's brother Donnie hit the road.
And it got to the point at one time that all three of the teams was running together. In fact, at one time, all three of us lived in one apartment, or we shared an apartment. And, you people look at what you've got now and really don't realize what we went through in the years when we was traveling. We didn't even have a shop. We used to keep the car over at the gas station, and he used to park them on the trailer up next to the fence, and a guy at the Shell service station over there named Joe would let us leave our cars. We didn't even have a shop to leave them in. And we'd all go back to one apartment with one bedroom, and then there'd be about 11 of us, and we'd just pile on the floors, on the couches, or wherever we had to sleep, and that's what we did. And we'd go over there if it wasn't raining, And we could, sometimes if they didn't have a lot of business, we could back our cars off the trailer up next to the fence. We work on them right out there in the sunlight like that. If it rained, we couldn't even work on them. And that's the way we traveled for a long time, you know, struggling to try to keep our head above water, which a lot of times we'd gamble the rent money on the tire.
Red, Bobby, and Donnie traveled together and either won or placed in so many races that their competitors and fans began to notice when the three teams entered the racetrack. People began referring to them as the Alabama Gang.
And we was really always kind of different because we won so many races, everybody tried to kind of copy us in extent. They saw we had it, they wanted it. So just to be different, one time we built three sedans and everybody ran coupes. There was no such thing as a sedan in the race car. Everybody had to run a 34 coupe. It was taboo. I mean, you just don't run a sedan. So we built three sedans. So we pulled into Bristol, Tennessee for a big 400 lap race in Bristol, Tennessee. Had about 80 cars there, and 77 of them were coupes, except for our three sedans, because that was a tension getter right there. They kind of laughed at us, really. But we ran we set 1, 2, 3 in qualifying, the first three spots in qualifying, and I won the race, and Bobby ran second. I think Donnie had the engine trouble or something. And he was running third at the time, and he had some kind of a problem breakdown in his car. But we would have run 1, 2, 3. And then we turn around and go to another racetrack maybe a month later, North Wilkesboro, we pull in there, run 1, 2, 3 there with cars again. And it just got to the locals would see us pulling in the gate, come pulling in the pits with three cars, and they said, here come that Alabama Gang again.
Back in those days, if you won, you did pretty good, and if you ran second, you really didn't do all that good financially. So the heat never eased up on the competition. So, you know, a lot of times when we were 1, 2, 3, the only guy that really sat there and grinned a lot was the guy that was one out of the 1, 2, 3.
Farmer had worked hard to develop his career. He spent the summers with the rest of the Alabama Gang touring the circuit. He spent winters in the Miami, Florida area working as an electrician whenever the work was available. And after a couple of years of commuting, Red decided it was time to put his family in one location. Alabama was treating him right, so he and Joan decided that that was where they would plant their roots.
He come up here to Birmingham for 2 years before we finally packed up and moved up here, because I didn't like the idea of him only being home maybe 2 months out of the year, because it got to where I would tell the children, this is your daddy, and show them a picture, you know, this is what your daddy looks like. So when he decided to do it, you know, and stay here, we sold everything we had in Miami, moved up here, and I really like it here. People say, where are you from? I say Birmingham. You know, it's my home.
1962 turned out to be a good year for Red Farmer. His wife and three children moved from Florida to Hueytown, Alabama. That was also the year he was approached by a representative from a local Ford dealer offering a sponsorship. Farmer had already established a tradition with his gold and white F97 Ford, and the merger with his new sponsor would aid his race team in the professional ranks and help him drive to 3 NASCAR National Sportsman Championships. He had already won 1 National Modified Championship in 1956. Vaughn Burrell remembers the excitement that Red Farmer exhibited from the very beginning of their friendship. Red's first request was for a 1962 Holman and Moody motor, costing the astronomical sum of $1,800. But the check was cut, and Farmer went to Charlotte, North Carolina to pick up that new power plant.
And we brought that thing in on the showroom floor, put it in the crate. I can remember it like it was yesterday. You rushed over and put the thing in real quick, preparing for the races. And I said, wait a minute, we don't know how this thing was going to work out, so don't put the name on it. And I don't want you to be dead last with Long Lewis' name on there. So you agreed on that. Then I was there that night, and about that day, and about the third lap, you came from the rear all the way to the front. And I said, boy, I wish I could put that name on it.
I wanted to try to find a fast sign painter, I believe.
When you're sponsoring someone, you don't want someone that's going to irritate some people. And I think Red has been tops in that department. I don't think anyone could please the fans or please the people that write about him. He's just been an all-around good public relations man as well as a race car driver.
Farmer has several other sponsors that have helped pay expenses for at least 10 years, and he feels these people have contributed greatly to his success.
They're not what you call big buck sponsors like that you've got, but if you get three or four small ones that all help you a little bit, it makes it much easier to survive. And I think that's the reason the sponsorship that a lot of the short track drivers make a mistake. They try to go out and get one big buck sponsorship to cover the whole season, whether they'd go out and get two or three smaller sponsors that would be willing to spend some money for short track, but they can't come up with the $20,000 or $30,000 from one sponsor, but they could come up with a part of it. So I think if a lot of drivers, if they would try to go out and get two or three small sponsors to carry them through the year rather than trying to get one big one, they try to get real one big one, they can't get it, they end up with no sponsor. So I think, you know, a bird in the hand's worth two in the bush. If you get three or four birds, you got a flock.
It was also in 1962 that Red Farmer began racing at Birmingham International Raceway.
Birmingham is probably one of the trickiest tracks to drive around here. It's a flat 5/8 mile racetrack. And the way to get around it off of the certain turns, you have to get into the corner a certain way. And it's just a real tricky racetrack to learn to drive. And we've always said that, you know, that Bobby and Donnie and Neil and myself, and there's a lot of other great drivers, like the Friday Hassler, Freddie Fryer, and a lot of these other guys all learned to drive at Birmingham. And it's always been said if you could learn to get around Birmingham right, you could go to about any other racetrack in the country and run on it without much practice, because it was, in other words, guys that would come from other racetracks would come there and they would be out of the ballpark completely. But yet we could come off of that racetrack and go anywhere else and be able to drive fairly easy.
Stock car drivers often compete with each other for national ranking. This ranking is determined by a point system, but today, racing teams travel by airplane and large transfer trucks. But in the late 60s and early 70s, Red Farmer, who was a championship contender, said that planes and 18-wheelers just weren't readily available for he and his crew.
Back in, in 69 or 70 or 71 when I was running for the national championship, we had to run any of the national championship races because they paid a lot of extra points. If we ran like at Birmingham on Friday night, it would pay maybe 50 points. But if they had a 200 lapper up in Washington, D.C. that paid 200 points the next night, it'd be the same thing as winning four short track races because you couldn't miss that point race. So we had to make them all to be able to win the national championships.
A typical week's schedule included a Friday night race at Birmingham International Raceway. Then after that event, Farmer and his crew would load up in a one-seat truck and travel to a different racetrack, normally in a different state. Upon arrival at that track, they would work on the car and the time left before the next race. Then they often return home to Hueytown at about 1 or 2 o'clock Monday morning. During their early years together, Bobby Allison was impressed with his friend's dedication to his profession.
Well, first of all, you know, he set a great example as far as personal commitment in racing. You know, no risk was too great, no obstacle was too big for him or anything. You know, he never quit trying until the checker flag went down. And that was obvious when you're around him all the time. His enthusiasm, constant enthusiasm, was great. And it was very contagious, too. So, you know, that was what I saw, just a guy that was loaded with talent and enthusiasm and willing to work all night if it took it, or willing to drive all night if it took that to get to the next event. All those things that a lot of people think make up too much work to go on to the next event or not really worth it or whatever. And it was always worth it to him. And like I say, that rubbed off.
Farmer has spent most of his career on short tracks. However, he knows his way around the super speedways as well.
I ran a little bit for a while, but we didn't have the financial backing that we need to be successful on the super speedways. At that time, most of the factories were in it. If you didn't have what you call a factory ride, like my Ford Motor Company or Chrysler or General Motors or something like that, you just didn't survive. They didn't have the outside sponsors like you've got nowadays. It was all factory sponsors. But there wasn't that many factory rides to go around, and I didn't have one, so I was to the point where I'm a kind of a driver that I would rather win races on the short track than I would run 10th or 12th in a 500-mile super speedway and be back there 10th or 12th where it didn't happen. Even though it was a good finish, it still was not winning. And, you know, I'm just like the thing, it's just not winning is like kissing your sister. It just didn't, you know, it's just not there. So, and I would rather run short tracks and win races than I would run super speedways and be an also ran, let's put it that way. I've always loved racing, but I enjoy people. I love to be around people, and I like to be friendly with everybody. Back at that time when the factories were in it, there was so much politics mixed with the factory backing that they wanted to try to dominate your life. In other words, they'd tell you who you could talk to, and if your best friend happened to be over driving the brand X, as they call it, or the other make, you weren't even supposed to speak to him. You know, you're supposed to ignore him and stuff like that. And to me, that just took something away from racing. And that's one reason I never did go to the Grand National Races. There was so much politics in it that they pulled strings and wanted you to jump around like a puppet, and I just couldn't go along with that.
In racing terminology, a super speedway is a track that is at least 1 mile long. To many people, the two most recognizable super speedways are located in Daytona Beach, Florida, and Talladega, Alabama. Now, outside the short tracks, these are the two tracks that Red enjoys most. Over the years, Farmer has given his colleagues some close, hard competition, but he has a difficult time winning. Well, when you ask about super speedway races, Farmer quickly recalls three. The first occurred in 1971 at Daytona. That was a race that tasted awfully sweet.
At the time, all of them's important. I mean, if you win a 25-lapper on a short track, it's important to you. You feel good about it because you've outrun the other 25 people. So you've had an accomplishment. They're all important. But I guess the biggest one, I would say, would be in 1971. I finally won the Permatex 300. I'd been running Daytona Beach since the beach course back in the Hudson Hornet in 1953 when we ran out there on the sand. And then they built a new super speedway in 1959. I ran the first race there in 1959, and I never missed a year. I ran all the way up to 71, so I'd been trying since 1959 to 1971 to win the Permatex 300. And I'd run second, I'd run third, and I'd run second, I'd run third, but I never had won that big race at Daytona, which is like pulling the brass ring, you know what I mean? Grabbing the ring, that was it. And when I finally won in 1971, it was just a great feeling at the time. And I think another reason it was such a great feeling to my mother. My mother had come to Daytona, and it was on February the 13th, Saturday, that I won that race. And that was the first race that my mother had ever been to a super speedway, and that was her birthday.
And the minute they said he had won, we lit out for the pits and over Victory Lane and over, and it was just so exciting. I just couldn't talk, I couldn't speak, I couldn't do anything. And we have a picture of it to show it was all happened. But that was on my birthday, and 13th, and some people are afraid of that, but that happened on February 13th.
Darrell Waltrip recalls wondering whether or not Red would even have his car ready for that race.
One time I remember down at Daytona, he always ran the Saturday race, and he had a really nice car, 67 Fairlane. I think it's the nicest car he'd ever owned. And he was getting ready to run that race on Saturday afternoon, and I was in it, one of the first ones I'd ever been in. And he had blown up a couple of engines. Daytona, as you know, is all sand everywhere at that time. And the afternoon prior to the race the next morning, Red had three engines torn down in the dirt, sand everywhere. And of course, as you know, sand is a worst enemy of an engine. He took three engines and made one, sand and all, put it in the race car and went out and won the Permatex 300 the next day. So he's that kind of guy. He just never gives up.
He's a true professional. He's the type of guy that he lives, breathes racing, and he's the epitome of what everybody wants to be as far as a driver. He's tough. I'd say if he'd started his career when he was in his early 20s on the major speedways, I've heard Bobby Allison say this many a time, that Red Farmer would have made us all look like schoolboys, and he's just a tremendous competitor. He's still a good driver.
1975 is another year Red quickly recalls. Prior to that race, a friend from the dirt track circuit asked for some tutoring from the elder member of the Alabama gang. Terry Mock lived in Jacksonville, Florida, and he had never driven any surface at all but dirt. He wanted to drive in the upcoming race at Daytona. Along with his mechanic, Terry spent 3 days in Hueytown, Alabama, taking a crash course on how to prepare his 69 fastback for his first super speedway race ever. He qualified, but neither he nor his mentor made more than 2 laps in that race.
When we come through the triangle, the tri-oval at Daytona, Terry didn't realize that the turn was as sharp as it is. It looked like it's pretty well straight, but on the racetrack, it's got a real curve to it. And we was trying to stay in the lines, and I was passing Terry on the outside, and he crossed the lane a little bit and got into my left rear and spun me and spun himself, and both of us went flying down through the grass, and we was around 180 miles an hour, and I was sliding through the grass, and it was all right. But then where the road course comes off the big track, there's a paved road that goes into the infield. Well, as I was sliding sideways, my tires hit that from the grass and hit the pavement. When it did, it started flipping. It went airborne. And they said it flips between 16, 18 times the time it stopped down a number one turn, totally demolished all the pieces. And that was, and Terry was wrecked also real bad. It totally demolished both race cars. But that was the worst wreck I think I've ever had. But it was kind of ironic that Terry is the one that wrecked me the first time he'd ever been there, and had just been at my house, spent 3 days with me, helped him out. And then he's the one, of course, I imagine he felt worse about it than I did.
The car turned out to be in worse shape than Farmer. The next day, he checked out of the hospital and attended the Daytona 500, where, according to his wife, he moved as though he were walking on eggshells.
He said he felt like he had been in a gang fight and his gang didn't show up, but they took him to the main hospital and, of course, you know, kept him overnight. And he told me when I left the hospital to go back to the motel, he said, "You be here at such and such a time in the morning with my clothes. We're going to the track." I said, "No, we're not." He said, "Yes, we are." Well, needless to say, we did.
Red Farmer did not have another super speedway win for 13 years. By 1984, he had been approached by the Corvin racing team, thus furnishing more income and support needed to build and maintain a super speedway car.
There wasn't but one that I wanted to drive. He's a legend. Also, to compress the time frame, time very critical. Here's a man that has a vast amount of knowledge and experience that is not on a learning curve because he doesn't need experience. Therefore, we could utilize the experience in the car, and it made for a great marriage. So he became the driver, and any car that I have, as long as he's able to drive, he'll always have the first refusal of that car.
Murphy's Law was applicable to practically every aspect of the 84 race. Farmer and his team had to get a provisional starting spot, which meant back of the pack on that 2.66 mile Talladega track. There was no radio communication between Red and the pit crew. Due to various circumstances, Farmer dropped 2 laps behind the lead. But maybe it was because everything that could go wrong already had. Red made up those 2 laps and led the race the last 40 laps. And not only did he lead the race, but he dominated and finished half a lap ahead of the second place car. That 1984 Talladega win was Red Farmer's second super speedway victory, occurring in his 35th year of racing, and it was on his home track. The next year, Red Farmer was back in Daytona, this time competing against another Hueytown neighbor, Davey Allison.
He was running second, and I was running third, and I was trying to beat him.
We got together, had a little fender bender. We played dirt tracking off the right away. I got out of shape. Actually, we hadn't hit each other. We straightened each other up. We were both out of shape, and then we got together, and we both got straight again and going again, and then lost it again in the tri-oval.
Yeah, on the last lap.
We were having fun. We was quarter mile in the super speedway by what we was doing, really. It turned out all right. We both ended up finishing second and third, but we both wanted to win it, and we actually messed each other up trying to get to the front. So that's the way it goes, though. As long as you're still loading back up in one piece, you won the race, I figure.
The headlines in the paper the next morning said, one's old, one's young, but they can both drive.
Red has competed on the Grand National Circuit. He took this 1972 Torino with just 7 miles on it and converted it into a Grand National car.
A year after we built it, we took it to Ontario, California with almost 100 race cars out there for the Ontario 500 and won the award for the best engineered car by an independent, which really made us proud because it was, like I say, it was a backyard-built car.
Red's best finish with this car was fourth place in the Talladega 500, just behind Bobby Allison. And this car is now on display at the International Motorsports Hall of Fame in Talladega, Alabama.
I guess if you asked the least race fan, the person that knew the least about racing, if you mentioned a name and said Richard Petty and Red Farmer, well, they'd recognize Richard Petty, but they may not recognize Red Farmer. But Red Farmer is indicative of the hundreds of thousands of drivers who are driving every week on a short track and have been driving probably for a long period of time and have just as much talent as any driver here, but just may not have gotten the proper brakes or maybe just never was in a position to get all the acclamation that a Richard Petty did get. But I'll guarantee you that Red Farmer, had he been given the opportunities that Richard Petty had, would have excelled just as Richard Petty did, and Red Farmer's name would be a household name throughout the nation.
I said dirt's for racing and asphalt's for getting there. And we always back and forth and kid each other on that back, and they said, no, asphalt's for racing, dirt for growing taters. I said, but we have a lot of fun, but actually dirt racing is altogether different from asphalt because your car is out of control more of the time. You're in a slide, you have to control your car under a slide. You go into the corner, break the back end around, you have to turn into the slide and then power it through the corner with the gas pedal. For asphalt, you go in straight, try to keep your car in a straight line and drive it through the corner straight. So it's actually an altogether different type of racing. It's kind of hard to explain to someone unless someone tried to do both racing, then they would understand the difference between the two of them. I think it's harder to learn to drive dirt and be a good dirt track driver than it is an asphalt driver. And I think a driver that learns to drive dirt and learns to control a car more or less out of control all the time, and once he got on an asphalt track, it would be fairly simple for him. So I think dirt track racing is a little bit harder to run, and in my opinion, I think an asphalt driver would have trouble going adapting to dirt more so than a dirt driver would going to adapting to the asphalt tracks.
One reason Red returned to the dirt track was due to the economy. One of the major expenses in auto racing is the cost of tires. Farmer and his crew found that they could use dirt tires much longer than those required for asphalt racing. Many Saturday nights are spent in Talladega, not at the super speedway, but across the street at the Talladega short track.
Asphalt racing maybe became where it was monotonous. It was the same every week. When I got back into dirt racing, it was like starting all over 30 years ago. And it was something new I had to learn. And it was interesting to me. And I couldn't win races. So I had to work harder and make changes. And it was just it was a learning process again. And that's what makes it interesting to me, I think, really. The fact that not being able to win and working hard and your crew working hard to try to get the car where it can win. And when you finally win, it's just a satisfaction of accomplishment that it makes it all worthwhile, really.
Like I say, he just lives life to the fullest. And, you know, whether he's fishing or out here on the half-mile track next to the major speedway here at Talladega, he runs just as hard there as he would for $100,000 over here at the big speedway.
On many dirt tracks, the gold and white F97 competes with car number 57. Red Farmer knows he's in for a race when Jerry Goodwin shows up. The unusual thing about these two drivers is that they compete on dirt, but Goodwin helps crew for Farmer when Red runs on asphalt.
Red Farmer is racing. He's a symbol of a racer. He has more energy than anybody I know of any age, and he puts in 150%. In 1978, I got burned severely in a race car accident. And in those days, Red and I weren't as personal friends as we are now. And the night I got burned, Red went up in the grandstands with his helmet and took up a collection from the fans and had the other drivers come up with him, and they took up a considerable amount, which really helped me. And he's the first person I remember waking up and seeing in the hospital, too. And ever since then, we've been real personal friends because of that. He's just a great guy. That's the kind of stuff he does for other people. He's a good gentleman on the racetrack, but if somebody pushes him around, he can be just as active as anybody else on the racetrack as far as taking care of himself and taking care of his car. And he's sort of hard of hearing, and we kid him about the hard of hearing, but he's not really, because when you say something about him, he hears every word of it. He hears everything. He hears what he wants to hear.
Red Farmer came up in racing back in the days where everything was not greatly commercialized. It was the days when the drivers, after the race, walked over into the grandstands and signed autographs, and that's Red Farmer's background. So he's one of the most personable and probably one of the most outgoing drivers that there are, just because he came from that era.
Whether it comes from that era or whether it's his personality, Red Farmer is one of the most popular people at any event he attends. The fans love him. Now, his fellow competitors might not go quite that far, but they will tell you how much respect they have for the old redhead. Eldon Yarborough is presently living in Guatemala. On a recent visit to Alabama, he gave his old friend and colleague a call. It had been 15 years since he and Farmer competed.
And Red's the type of man that I used to race with. I loved to race with Red. If you raced with Red, you knew you didn't have any problems. And I raced ahead of him, I raced behind him. He raced ahead of me and raced behind me. But we had a great time racing our career with each other throughout Florida, Georgia, some Alabama, and some in Carolina.
You never know whether he's serious or not. He puts you on pretty big, but he is a great driver, and I think any of the guys have a great deal of respect for him, no matter what he's running. If he's running half mile dirt, he can drive well. If he's running half mile asphalt, he's very good. And if he goes to Daytona, he's a very good competitor. He's the type of race driver that very few people can say they can drive everywhere.
You know, I think another thing, he's always felt like he could win a race, and he could win a race even if the other guys had the very best everything. And that's kind of a neat situation, that cockiness, personal confidence really is there. And he's always had that. He's the type of guy that would brag until you really wanted to, put your foot in his mouth. And then he'd go out on the racetrack and he'd back up all his bragging. And, of course, that would make even madder.
From a driver's standpoint, like I said earlier, I think he's a great driver, no doubt about that. Everybody can say that. And also a good person from a driver's standpoint. From a fan standpoint, I'm sure all the fans, even though Red hadn't raced and ran Hickory or some of our tracks in years, that name always comes to the top of their mind. You know, when you say Red Farmer, I think everybody knows Red Farmer.
He's just a good all-American guy, I guess you can say. And when you say Red Farmer, the first thing they think of is NASCAR racing, you know. They don't think Red Farmer has it just pops up. Red Farmer, racing, you know. How's old Red doing? Well, Red's still racing. How's he been doing? He's been winning. He's always been winning.
He's a hard racer. One of the best racers I ever drove against. And you could lean on him, and he'd lean on you. And he'd holler and squeal a little bit. Man, what are you trying to do? And his cars were always so beat up that you could never tell where you hit him or where he hit you, because the car was always just so beat up, but it always run good. And he worked hard, a hard working man, and did all the work himself. And what Red has accomplished, he can be proud of, because he's responsible for most of it.
Occasionally, Red enters his fourth car in an enduro race. Now, this race is different from any other. It may be run on dirt or it may be on an asphalt surface, but the only rule in this race is that you have to finish, endure.
It's a fun type of racing, but they've got to where they're paying pretty good money in it, but it's really fun to me. The first one I ran was in Pensacola, was a big 300 lapper, and they paid $10,000 to win. And we had to race one at 240 laps with a lap lead on the field and a fan belt broke. So I had a $10,000 fan belt. But We started 150-something, 156 cars in that race on a half-mile track. And that's a lot of race cars. And there's no flags, green flag and a checker, no cautions, no red flags, no stopping the race. And it's just, you just like getting out there at 5 o'clock work traffic and with no traffic cops around and telling you just get there as quick as you can and getting through traffic. And that's just about what it amounts to. But you've got to still be there at the end of the race to make any money because they don't use the pavement by 10 positions out of 156. But you've got to endure and finish the race. And that's what makes it exciting.
And the jam car, the purpose of it will be out to go out and separate the problems that develop on the racetrack.
At the end of 150 laps, who would know if it was 149, the red flag was displayed and a mandatory pit stop ordered. Over 80 machines began the second half, and veteran Red Farmer in the Red 5A was leading until a radiator hose gave out. At race time, all the focus is placed on the driver. Oftentimes, he receives special attention. Now, Red Farmer never takes all the credit for his accomplishments. He knows what it takes to win. A hard-working, dedicated crew.
I mean, it's just like a quarterback trying to run a football team without linemen. You know, he's history. If he didn't have them linemen up there to block for him, they got the ball from the center, he'd be mud. So, I mean, you've got to have those men blocking. That's the same when racing. It's such a team effort that you wouldn't believe it. We don't have the big buck sponsorship, so they don't get anything for it. They don't get paid for it. They do it for the same reason I do. They enjoy seeing the car that they built an engine for, or they help a pair. Chuck's over building a motor for it. Richard's over there working on the chassis and the springs and mountain tires. When we go out and win races with that car, they get the same satisfactions I do from winning. Maybe not the same, but they feel proud for the work that they've done, that we've gone out and outrun the other 25, 30 cars. So it gives them satisfaction, too. And I think that's one reason that maybe the fact that if I do win races, or I win a lot of races, I can keep a crew longer.
If you worked for them and got paid, you'd probably quit. But when you do it because you want to, you enjoy it. We in the shop and at the racetrack, where sometimes we'll holler at each other and jump and scream, and we all know that it's all part of the game that we play. And really great to be around. And then, you know, he doesn't ask you to do anything that he won't do. It's not you go get dirty and I'm going to stay here and be the star or whatever. He'll get in there and get dirty with you and do whatever work needs to be done. So really, you couldn't ask for a better boss.
What it might look like to other people, we know what, you know, what we're doing, and we got our way of doing things. But other people think it's, you know, maybe disorganized to them, but it's organized to us because we know how we got accomplished it, and we do it our way because it's the quickest way, because we've done tried everything. And we do it our way, and we don't care what they think, you know, because it'll be the quickest way.
Well, sometimes Farmer's organization's not ours either. He's got his own system for organizing, like in the shop or whatever. There could be a pile of something somewhere, and you'll move it 3 feet, or you'll say, this is no good, throw it out. The next day, he realizes it's gone, or there's something he hadn't used in 5 years, and he knows where it's hidden under a pile somewhere, and he'll go get it. So he's got his own organization and whatever to keep up with his tools, equipment, parts, whatever. If the car wins, we win. If the car loses, we lose. You know, we don't go and say, well, you know, you made a mistake. You should have done this or done that, because he's going to make mistakes, same as we're going to make mistakes. And whether it's basketball, baseball, football, or whatever, but the whole team loses and we all lose, but at the same time, we all win when we win something. And I think that we're probably prouder of a win than he is.
As is the case in any sport, injuries are just part of the game. And Red Farmer is the first to admit that he probably has had more broken bones than anybody else on the racing circuit. How's this for a checklist? Twice his left leg has been broken. His left kneecap is only but a memory at this time. Ribs, they've been broken time and again. He has dislocated his left shoulder so many times, just about everybody has lost count. And even in preparing for a race, an alcohol fire burned some 40% of his body, an injury that Red to this day calls his most painful. His wife says that when her husband has had injuries, no matter where he is, he always wants to return home to Hueytown to mend. Once, she had to reserve 2 seats on an airplane so Red could stretch out until he arrived at the airport, where an ambulance was waiting to transport him to the hospital.
Now, he loves to travel to races, but Red wants to be home after those races.
We have chauffeured Red around, possibly in 1970, 69, when he was running for the championships and everything. We had a station wagon. And there was this other fella and myself that we were the chauffeurs. Red would sleep in the back of the station wagon, and we'd drive all night, half of the day, to get to a racetrack, race, and then get back in the station wagon. He'd sleep, and we'd chauffeur him. We'd get lost in the fog, and I'm telling you, but it was fun, except for the times that I'd get the calls, and I'd have to go, like the time I went to Laurel, Mississippi. They called me in the middle of the night, and he'd been in a real bad wreck. It was when he was driving Skeeters.
When an axle broke on his car, Farmer was spun around into a wall, and that's the last thing he remembered.
That wall there. Well, I hit that thing sideways right at the point of the car around the transmission, and it cut the car in two at the transmission and left the imprint of one tire in the driveway and the other one out on the racetrack. And a complete night and cut the car in two. Of course, I didn't remember because I was unconscious at the time. But anyway, when I come to 4 or 5 hours later, I was laying in the Laurel Hospital looking up at the lights on the operating table. And I had a real severe, I broke three vertebrae in my back and about five or six ribs, and I had a concussion, was unconscious, and plus other bruises and stuff that I had, but I was still alive anyway.
He was broke up and busted up real bad, and they had him sedated real, real good. And he developed pneumonia, and they had to keep turning him in the bed. Well, for two or three nights, I slept on the floor beside him.
I had one of the most painful things at the time because I had my back was messed up in such a way that it was pinching a nerve in my back that was causing me such back pains in one portion that if I even blinked my eyes, it felt like that somebody was just stabbing a knife into my side. I couldn't even move. It's the most painful thing I've ever seen because I could do nothing for relief, and they couldn't do anything for relief. And finally, after quite a few days of pain that they could never seem to relieve, they had to go in there and put a nerve block and cut a nerve in my spine to kill the pain in my back. And I've got one numb spot on my lower back now from where they had to kill that nerve.
And finally, he was raising such commotion that he wanted to come home. He wanted to come home. And we had to get an ambulance to bring him from Laurel, Mississippi back up here to Hueytown. We get him home, have to rent the hospital bed. And he was down for about 2 weeks. And I think to keep him down any longer than that, we would have had to chain him to the bed. But in the meantime, that car got cut up by me. When it got brought home, they said, they can fix it up, they can fix it up, which I never liked the car to begin with. That's the only one I've never liked. There wasn't that much to it. And I personally went out with a cutting torch, and I finished wrecking the car. Yes, I think he's got a piece of it left out there somewhere. But he wasn't very happy about that, but I wasn't very happy about the condition it put him in either. I said, I think that's the only time I ever got brave enough. I gave him a choice. It was either that kind of car or me and his children.
That's part of racing, I guess. Part I don't like to remember, but it's a part that's always there. I mean, you've got to take the good with the bad, I guess.
Richard!
Family and friends noticed Farmer's hearing difficulty. After a great deal of coaxing, Red had his hearing checked and learned he was 48% deaf. This loss of hearing has contributed to the early years when stock car exhausts were released in front of the face. Farmer now wears hearing aids in both ears. On May 2nd, 1987, Red Farmer appeared in the ARCA 500-kilometer event at the Alabama International Motor Speedway. The story was not just Saturday, May 2nd, but the entire weekend. Red Farmer had to be the busiest man in Talladega and Hueytown. The Super Speedway car was built in Bessemer. It arrived at the Speedway Thursday. And with only three laps on his new vehicle, Red Farmer qualified at a speed of over 199 miles an hour. Now, Red was happy with that early qualifying since That left him all day Friday to practice and allowed the crew to set the car up for Saturday's race. Thursday night, Farmer returned home to finish last-minute preparations on the dirt track car that he would race the next night. Friday, he arrived with the dirt car, but business turned back to the Super Speedway car. And then at 4:30, he returned to the track for that last run, and then the motor blew an oil line. Upon hearing of his friend's mechanical problems, Bobby Allison quickly was on the spot. He told the crew that he would be available later that evening to help repair the motor for the next day's race. The crew then moved quickly to pull the motor and make the trip to Hueytown for what was going to be an all-night session, hoping to get Red on the track the next day for the 1 o'clock green flag. With the motor headed for Hueytown, Red Farmer then headed for his next task, that special Friday night dirt race. Red Farmer was back to his roots, dirt track racing. And it's obvious how much this stock car veteran enjoys competing on the dirt, but Farmer wasn't able to finish this race.
And one of the guys up there, in about three or four cars in front of me, crossed up. I couldn't really see what happened. And he lost it and turned sideways, and another one hit him, and there's about three or four of them, and the track was completely blocked with four cars sideways. And I saw it, and I got on the brakes and slid up to the wreck, but I wasn't even hurt at all. In fact, I was sick to put it in reverse and try to back up, and about that time, four of them behind me didn't get stopped in time, and they just plowed into the car. And from not being hurt, I ended up with all four corners bent up on the car. But I was right in the middle of a sandwich. I think it was nine wrecks, and I was the four and a half one right in the middle of it.
So it was back down the interstate to his Hueytown garage to work on this car so he could run again Saturday after the Super Speedway race, which was now just a few hours away. Meanwhile, Bobby Allison was down the street in his Hueytown garage working on the motor of Red's Super Speedway car. Red stopped work long enough to check on Allison's progress. Well, like any growing boy, Farmer was in bed by 2:30 Saturday morning. His crew was back at the Speedway garage when the gates opened at 7, and they began installing the rebuilt motor. There were four drivers in that group that Red competes with on other racetracks, and he felt confident that these men knew what they were doing and that when he pushed the world's fastest banana to 200 miles an hour, all the parts would be in place. By 11:30, a crowd began to form in the Farmer garage area, asking if the car would be ready in time for the 1 o'clock start. Like his father, Davy Allison would be racing the Winston 500 the next day. About noontime, he dropped by the garage to check on his good friend to see firsthand if Farmer would be in the lineup. At 12:30, the motor had yet to be started. But 10 minutes later, it cranked. With 10 minutes till race time, the banana was wheeled to the fueling tanks and then pushed into the 13th spot in the lineup with just 60 seconds to spare.
And now we have a battle for the lead developing as Red Farmer has come on to move in on their lead car, number 51 of Dave Simcoe.
Bill Scott's pit was adjacent to Farmer's, and when Scott's car burst into flames, number 97 was waved away from the pit area, causing him to lose valuable time, as well as calling for a stop after the Farmer crew moved all of their equipment to another area. So finding his new pit stall was just something else that the old redhead had on his mind.
Look at Red Farmer on the top of the racetrack.
Boy, they are really mixing it up. Farmer lost some ground on the racetrack during the last set of pit stops, but he's able to come back up, and he has ascended to third position. Red Farmer is now third.
Red finished the race in third place.
You know, we're happy with a third place finish in the 500 mile with a brand new car after starting 13th with all the problems that we did have with it during the week trying to get the car finished. Actually, it needed about two more days before it should have been raced, so I was real happy with it.
But the day was not over for Farmer. He would again cross the street and run the Talladega short track Saturday night. Halfway through the race, rain called a halt to Red Farmer's third race in 2 days. So it was back to Hueytown for a couple hours sleep, and then back to Talladega to watch fellow Alabama gang members Bobby and Davey Allison and Neil Bonnet compete in the Winston 500. Unfortunately, Bobby blew a tire and crashed, but he was lucky to walk away from the accident. But the good news of the day was Davey Allison's first place finish in the Winston 500. This win had special meaning for Red Farmer, because he had been crew chief for Davey for a portion of last season. So what does Red Farmer do after a weekend like Talladega? He and his family go to the lake and spend a few days relaxing and catching fish.
Come here, let me show you my fish. How about that one, huh?
A fish?
Yeah.
You call yourself a fisherman?
Yeah,
it's a
fish. Let me
show you something. I'll show you who's a fisherman in the family. Now, who's the fisherman?
That's fish. That's fish.
I'm leaving.
One thing's for sure. The words fishing, relaxing, and Red Farmer are rarely used in the same sentence because Red is a racer, and he just can't stay away from those race cars.
I've got a chosen profession that I chose to do myself. And it's not something that was forced on to me or that I had to do or my father did it and I had to do it or something like that. My sport is my hobby and I do it full time. So as long as I can make a living doing at it, it's not easy, but I don't think there's anything easy anymore, especially when you're doing something that you really like to do. The more I run, the more I work, the better I can keep my body in shape and adapted to racing. But if I sat down in a rocking chair, as you said, and sit for a couple of months, I probably wouldn't be able to get up. So I'm just going to keep on going.